YouTube, this is Michigan Snow Pony Renee, and I'm still catching up on videos, including doing my Ask Me Anything series, which are supposed to be done on Fridays, but I do them whenever I can. And I'm way behind in that, so this is probably going to be a multi-segmented type video. So anyway, let's get started. First of all, I am kind of celebrating today because my husband went back to work. He's been off for almost a month. And all I can say is thank goodness for extended pantries and living pretty much debt-free, or this bump in the road would have been a lot worse. So get your extended pantries built up and try to get out of debt. Okay, let's get down to the questions. EL and MZ Garden had some pig questions, and I kind of combined your questions so all the pig stuff would be together. What kind of breed of pigs do you have? Mine are supposed to be Cooney Coonies, which is a native breed of New Zealand, but I think mine are crosses. I don't think they're purebred. How much do pigs eat anyway? Well, that depends on what you're trying to do. Are you trying to just maintain them like a breeding pair or a breeding sow, or are you trying to get them to a market weight? Because that makes a big difference. It also makes a big difference on what kind of pigs they are. The heritage pigs tend to gain a little slower. I don't think they're bred to eat as much as the nice pink commercial pigs. But the nice thing about, so that's a hard question to answer, but the nice thing about pigs is they're omnivores. You can feed them just about anything, and they will survive just fine. Whether it's acorns, or windfall apples, or hay, or old produce from the garden, or your local grocery store, or commercial pig feed, whatever. You can feed them a variety of things, and I think after chickens, they are like the next best homestead animal to raise, as far as doing so with an eye towards frugality. And I think it was MZ, no, or L, I don't remember who asked which question, but one of them asked, who is in central Kentucky, whether you need a shed or a barn to overwinter your pigs. Absolutely not. My pigs are outside in the winter, in our Michigan winters, and what I do is I provide a calf hutch for them and bed it up really heavily with straw, and they'll go right in there and make a den of sorts and be perfectly fine. You have to remember, pigs go feral very easily in all different climates. There are feral pigs in Siberia. So even the breeds that are from a tropical type or temperate type area of the world will be fine if you provide them just a shelter and enough bedding. They'll grow hair and they'll take care of themselves. So let's see. Have you seen any information on odorless pig pens which require a charcoal as a base? No, I haven't. I would be curious how that would work because pigs tend to root. So I'm not sure how you'd keep that base intact. Do you have a problem with keeping odor down? I honestly don't. Each of my pigs is in a 16 by 16 foot area, and they use one area of it as their potty. And you can clean that out if you want, or put some like sweet PDZ you mentioned. You can do that, some lime, whatever. And I'm also on very sandy, well-drained soil. If you're on clay, you might get into more of a muddy, smelly type situation. But I haven't experienced that myself. Most people do not know I have pigs until they go back there and they see them. They don't smell them before they see them. I can't say that about my billy goat. Does diet affect waste odor? I really don't know. That's a good question. I don't know. Let's see. Will the wallow become strong smelling? No, because the pigs won't poop there, to be perfectly blunt. So it will just be a little muddy area or a little pond for them. I don't notice their wallow getting fouled at all or being smelly. It may grow mosquitoes if you are in that kind of climate. And if mine tends to drain away and then I fill it back up and it drains away. So that's how I keep the mosquitoes out of there. But if you're in, again, a clay-based area, you might be promoting mosquitoes. So keep that in mind. But okay, from Sheila. First of all, Thank you for the lovely note that you sent. And yes, I'm sure we would be best friends if we lived next to each other, because you obviously recognize a fun, wonderful person when you see one. Sheila is having some technical problems with YouTube, and it always cracks me up when people ask me about, you know, anything to do with the computers, because I'm not well-versed that way at all. I barely get my videos up. So I'm going to just read what she wrote, so maybe some of you can help her out in the comment section. Okay, and she says, I don't know how to get around on YouTube. I've tried several times to comment, and apparently without an account, I can't. I've tried to open an account, and the page looks like it has an error on it, and when I click the different options, nothing happens. It would seem that I already have an account, however, since I can subscribe to various YouTubers, such as yourself. I don't understand how to program a computer, but I don't generally have such difficulty getting around on different websites. Any idea what I'm doing wrong? So there you go, guys. She can subscribe. She can't comment. Can you help her out? Put it in the comment section. And Sheila, read the comments. Sorry, I can't be more help. I'd also like to say hello to Bristol, who is 13 years old, and she also sent me a nice note, and I have a feeling she is another kindred horse person spirit. So hello, Bristol. I like your name. Carrie writes, regarding the Robinson curriculum, I just started my son, age 12, and my daughter, age 10, on this curriculum. They're doing okay in the math, but I'm having a hard time with the CDs. The science section is too hard for them, and I'm not sure where to start them on the reading or the grammar stuff. Plus, do they do an essay every day that they read so that that is part of their English curriculum? I'm just confused. Yeah, I think you have a distinct advantage if you start with the Robinson from the get-go. But I, like you, put my girls into it after 3 or 4 years of public school. And it is hard to just jump in the middle and figure out where to put them, especially with the reading. But you just start somewhere, and if it's too easy, then you go up further down the list and just keep trying different books until you kind of get a feel, or they get a feel, that they're in the right spot. I'm not sure about science, because my Robinson curriculum had no science. It's strictly English, reading, literature, vocabulary, and it also is math using the Saxon math books. That's all my Robin curriculum is. Now, I bought it used, so maybe I have an older version than you do, or if you bought it used, maybe you have an older version than I do. But my understanding is that Robinson doesn't focus on science until they have the math under their belts, because there's so much upper-level math and chemistry and stuff and physics. So they want the kids to get through the math before they introduce the science. That's my understanding of it. But I don't worry if the reading and the grammar, and I'll admit I do find that the tests after some of the books that they read in the Robinson are not well written. There's always the vocabulary afterwards, and my girls do okay with that. But as far as the actual test, and it's not comprehension, it's more of the analogies, I don't worry about that. I augment them with spelling tests, and we discuss the content of the book, and as long as they're getting that and comprehending what they read, and they're reading good literature, which I think the Robinson does encompass, I don't worry about the other stuff. I want them to get the basics down pat, and then teach themselves how to learn, and that's the other thing Robinson is about, is having kids go at their own pace and teach themselves. Because once they can do that, the sky's the limit. They can teach themselves anything if they learn how to do that. So that's why I like the Robinson. But I sympathize with you starting late. It is harder. But don't give up. Just give yourself time to get your footing in it. And don't worry about the science. It will come later. My girls are going to be going to a one-day school on Fridays this coming year. For homeschool kids. It's a local church runs it. It's from 8:30 to 3:30. And they are going to be there for social reasons, but also they're going to be learning karate, writing, there's gym, art, music, and something called Market Day, where they learn the principles of marketing, and then they sell a product or develop a product. I'm not quite sure, but they're excited about it. And so I think that's going to round out our curriculum, and I want to get into some geography too. So, you know, and this is the thing with homeschooling is as you go, you get more of a feel of which direction you want to go in. And but starting out is very intimidating, so don't get discouraged. And you always feel like, I'm cheating my kids, I'm not doing enough. I think every homeschool parent feels that way, especially if you start comparing notes to other homeschool parents. Oh, you're doing that? Oh, your kids do that? Oh. And you start getting real insecure about what you're doing. Don't go there. Don't go there. You're doing the best you can for your kids because you know your kids. And you'll be fine. Just give yourself time to get your footing there. And then y'all, all three of you, take off. Okay. From Brenda, I have been canning for 3 years, water bath. This summer, the apricots oozed out 1.5 inches of the liquid during canning. That's maddening, isn't it? They look lovely and they sealed, but the liquid level is not covering the fruit. They started out with the correct headspace. What possibly happened, and does it matter? We've all had that happen. Even those of us that have canned for years and years. I'm gonna refer to my notes because I know I'm gonna forget something. Why this might have happened? Okay, a few things can cause this. With somebody's playing the Wii. With pressure canning, it can be uneven temperature, but that isn't so much with the water bath because it gets to boiling and it just stays there. So the culprit is usually one of three things. And did you remember to run a spatula around the jar and release the air bubbles? Did you do that? Because that's kind of a big one that will cause it to leak out if you forgot to do that. The other thing, let's see. Oh, the other thing is, did you make sure that your jars were covered by at least 1 inch of water on the top? You want at least 1 inch, no less. That can cause the contents to bubble out. And what's the third one? I see a new one. Oh, yeah. Did you pack the jars too tightly? And this confuses people because when you're pressure canning and like you're doing meat, you want that jar packed as tight as you can. But that's not necessarily true with water bath canning. Now granted, if you don't pack it tight enough, you'll have floaty fruit on the top and then your liquid in the bottom, and that doesn't look good. It's perfectly fine, it just doesn't look good. You're not going to win a prize at the fair. But you don't want to pack it too tightly. And every fruit's a little different. You'll get a feel for it as you go. But that might have been if your fruit was packed too tightly in there. So don't worry about it. What's going to happen is the fruit that's above the liquid line, it's going to turn brownish. It's going to get a little discolored. Doesn't hurt it. It just is not aesthetically pleasing. But as long as your jar's sealed, it's not going to hurt it. And some people will even flip the jars in storage when they don't have enough liquid to try to keep everything, you know, try to cover it as best they can. But just use that jar up first. No big deal. But as long as it's sealed, it's okay. And as long as it didn't lose over half of the liquid. If it lost over half, yeah, put that one in the fridge and use it first. But if it didn't, if there's just a little bit of your fruit poking up high, it's fine. Okay? And it happens to all of us. And then we get just as frustrated. Katie writes, my husband and I are moving to our soon-to-be little homestead. Yay! We are getting meat goats. I was wondering if you could give us some suggestions on pasture grasses you would recommend for goats. Well, I don't know where you are, but just be aware that goats are browsers like deer, not necessarily grazers. Now, they'll graze on pasture if that's all there is, but they really like browse. And if you have a pasture, but there's no like brambles in it, wild roses, they love those, poison ivy, that kind of thing, try to get a legume out there, like alfalfa or something like that, or a clover. If that's in your pasture, that's really good, at least for dairy goats. Now, you're asking me about meat goats, and I have never raised meat goats. So this is advice coming from a dairy goat person, a production person. But I'm assuming it's probably about the same, because I want my goats to have a high nutrition so they fill my milk pail, and you want them to fill your freezer. So I would think their nutritional needs would be about the same. But I don't pasture my goats. They won't stay in my fencing. That's the major reason. I have 7 acres of fence pasture, and my goats won't stay in it. So they don't respect electric fencing. So I don't have a lot of experience with pasture and goats. My advice would be to try to find other people in your area that have meat goats, that have them on pasture, and find out what they're planting, and go from there. I'm sorry I can't be more help there. Angel writes, my question for you is, at what time do you slaughter your chickens? I just bought a piece of land, and my husband and I are trying to build ourselves up with animals and a garden. We have 7 chickens. When do I slaughter my chickens? When I want to. Actually, to have the best quality meat, you want to slaughter your chickens before they're a year old. After a year, they're what they call stewing hens. And that doesn't mean you can't eat them, but they're not going to be that young, fresh, succulent bird that they were in their younger years. Stewing hens, though, do fine in a pressure cooker or a crock pot dish, or I like to boil them up, take all the meat off, make fabulous chicken salad. So you slaughter your chickens when you want to, unless you have the commercial meat chickens, and that's like the Cornish Rock crosses, those types. You need to slaughter them between 8 and 12 weeks. Because if you wait longer, they will die on you, because they aren't bred to live healthily beyond that point. They just get fatter and fatter, and pretty soon they can't support their own weight on their legs, and it's not a pretty picture. So if you're raising those kind of chickens, the meat birds, commercial meat birds, 8 to 12 weeks. If you've got an old heritage breed of chicken, whenever you feel like it. But if you go after a year, you're not going to have a succulent, nice bird as those ones that are younger. So, Mary Sue writes, I have a question for you. Do you have any piglets yet? No. And how have the girls done with the goats at the fair? Hope you're having a wonderful summer. Well, Lena does goats. Charlotte doesn't. And she did very well. My daughter's motioning. She's got to go to her sewing class. Lena did very well at our first fair. We go to 2 in the summer. And took first. Oh, geez, I can't remember. Did she take first in showmanship?
Yeah.
Okay, she took first in showmanship. She took Grant, the one that she delivered. And she took first in her little weather class. But that's a smaller fair. The next fair we go to, way more competitive. And she's going to be taking 3 goats, and Charlotte's taking 2 rabbits. So that's next week. So I'll tell you how they do then. Okay, I got one more question. And then I'm going to have a separate video for the last question. Pam from Falmouth Farms writes, I recently saw a video on how to make zucchini mock apple pie and have been trying to find a way to adapt it so I can home can this mock filling. Zucchini isn't a high acid food, so water bath canning is not an option. That's right. But pressure canning will surely turn the zucchini to mush. I would think so too. Do you think medium cubes of zucchini would dehydrate and rehydrate well, or would the cube zucchini be too much for dehydrating? No, zucchini dehydrates beautifully. Now normally I've done just the shreds for zucchini bread, but this year I've been doing slices. I didn't do cubes, but slices would work just as well. Can you see that? These are dehydrated zucchini. There's about 2 or 3 medium zucchinis in here. But they would work in a mock apple pie, I would think. Just 2 slices. And I slice them about 1/4 inch thick or less, and they're done like 12, 15 hours. So there you go. I remembered my prop. Okay. All right. That's all for this segment. And I have one kind of special question I'm going to put in the next video. Bye, guys. Boy, I hope this was recording.